Good evening, everyone. Hi, I'm Bob Appel, and I have the privilege of being the chairman of Jazz at Lincoln Center. I want to welcome everyone here this evening. Thank you. To what I'm sure will be a wonderful evening of music and recognition of some of our most beloved jazz artists. I want to start by thanking Joan Chikakawa, the acting chairman of the NEA, who will be hosting this evening. And of course, I want to give personal congratulations to our distinguished honorees, Mose, Allison, Lou Donaldson, Lorraine Gordon, and Eddie Palmieri. You know, it's 30 years, or over 30 years now, where the NEA has given special recognition to jazz artists through its Jazz Masters program, which is by far the nation's highest honor for jazz musicians. And since 2008, Jazz at Lincoln Center has been honored to be the participant for the annual dinner and performance. So I would like now just simply to acknowledge and thank the NEA for their collaboration with Jazz and Lincoln Center, for supporting jazz music, and most of all for recognizing these wonderful musicians who add so much to American culture. So welcome again, and please enjoy this wonderful evening. Thank you.
It's a hybrid of like all the different influences from Mississippi, just completely steeped in blues. Where he lived was the absolute Delta. You can hear it in his piano playing even. It's really evocative of the place. And that kind of humility, it's like a musical manifestation of him.
Stole the blues.
I used to go to the filling station and listen to the jukebox. That's how I learned about the country blues. Big Bill Brunzy had a song, Digging My Potatoes. What do you think? Well, I was playing trumpet at the time, and I liked Louis Armstrong for different reasons. He had a lot of records that were ambivalent. That word came to me in New Orleans. There's an ambivalent street in New Orleans. It's just the way I am.
There was a pavilion where you go to dance, and he was in the band there. And then we wrote to one another for 2.5 years. He was really fun to write to. I saw you 21 days in the 2.5 years. And then we decided we'd get married. It was always hearing about some music going on, and it would take us about 30 minutes to pack up, and with the ironing board on top, I remember that.
Ever since the world ended, I don't go out as much.
I always said I was going to make a living at music, and I had to come to New York to do that.
I think I saw that he was so focused on that and so dedicated to it, and also all the other musicians treated him as if he were really something special. He had this wonderful thing that made him so happy, and I just admired that, and I wanted to have that.
It was slow at first, and eventually I got enough jobs to get known. I was pretty much self-determined. The Jazz Loft, that was on 34th Street and the 3rd Avenue. They used to have jam sessions every night.
I do know that they have audio from a session. They're going, Mose, don't go home, it's only midnight. And he's like, no, I have to go home, it's Christmas. Now, people will ask, oh, it must have been so cool. Growing up, you must have had, like, jam sessions of musicians in the house. You know, absolutely not. We didn't feel like he was famous. When he was home, it was never about him.
My definition of jazz is music that's felt, thought, and performed simultaneously. And that's what I'm looking for, you know, every night. Now, nobody plays jazz all night. The jazz part is when you get into something that you haven't done before, and you're thinking it and feeling it and performing it right there.
Just another little middle-class white boy out trying to have some fun.
Following over the years, so when I play, it's like nostalgia. If you want to hear the kind of stuff I play, you got to hear me, because nobody else is playing it. Whenever I play a ballad, I try to get a tone like Johnny Hodges, like he used to slur notes and sustain certain notes on his saxophone. And I try to move through the chords like Charlie Parker. It's just a cross between blues and bebop. And most of my stuff would be called the soul side because of all the experience I had with my father and church music. First time I heard jazz was on a radio station, WBT, from Charlotte, North Carolina, which was a country and western station. That's all they played. But they had one disc jockey there, a guy named Grady Cole, and he had one record, Louis Armstrong, and he played that every day because he loved that. And that's my first time hearing jazz music. I heard Charlie Parker when I was in the Navy. I like Charlie Parker's sound. Most of the jazz before bebop was dance music. Very few bands ever played concerts. Dizzy and Charlie Parker had a smaller group, and they played a lot of solos. Dance bands, you didn't have many solos. But bebop, everybody could play on every song. Bands kept coming through, like Dizzy and Lionel Hampton. And I'd sit in with the band, and they kept telling me to come to New York. We had about 10 clubs right in Harlem where you could go and play. Men's was the best club to play. It's like a joint. And everybody came there. Roy Eldridge, Billie Holiday, Ella Fitzgerald, Sarah Vaughan. They worked downtown, but their jobs ended at 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock. So about 2 o'clock, all of them were there. The people would flock in to see them. Joe Louis, Malcolm X, Adam Clayton Powell. So sometime we'd play till 5 o'clock, but it was great. The circuit was the most amazing thing that's ever happened since I've been in the jazz business. We started in Rochester, we hit Buffalo, St. Louis, Kansas City. When we went to a new place that we'd never played, we played a cross section of music. We'd play fast, we'd play slow, we'd play blues, we'd play ballads. Whatever the people responded to, that's where we laid.
Because she's mine, oh mine.
We sneak in a couple of bebop tunes and anything that we wanted to play. But once we got them in our pocket, it's still working now. It's just a rewarding profession. I don't know anything else that a person could do more rewarding than being an artist. I'm still able to play just about as well as I always did. Sometimes I sit back and think about it, and I say, well, God must have been on my side. And I'm not a religious man. My wife was. And she used to tell me, well, I'm praying for you. That's why you're all right. Because it's never up to you. You'd be gone.
Recording of my own, they stopped and what is that? What is this that we're hearing? What's the matter? And everybody's looking at, and then they realized it was me. So now they either wanted to cover the whole piano or to gag me when I played. It was a mess, you know. The guy goes, look, that's the way he plays, just leave him alone.
Yeah.
mother arrived in 1925 from Puerto Rico. Father arrived in 1926. I was born in Manhattan, but we moved by 1941 into the Bronx. The Bronx was gorgeous then, you know? And my grandfather and my father were partners of the most beautiful luncheonette. My mother and grandmother cooked, and I was like the soda jerk, but I controlled the jukebox. And I would have Tito Puente, Tito Rodriguez, my Chito, which was the orchestra. We had the hippest jukebox in the Bronx, and it was called the Mambo. I named it. I wanted to be a dance orchestra leader, and I was able to fulfill my dream. And at 8 years old, I went on the piano. And then I wanted to be my brother's drummer because Tito Puente had made the timbales very popular. I was banging all over the house, and my grandfather told my mother, you know, you better get the kid, you know, the timbales he's asking for, because he's ruining all the lamps, all the furniture. So then my mother, being brilliant, only superiority of women could do that, okay? She bought me a metal box that weighed more than two or three pairs of timbales. And as I picked up this box, this metal box, she would tell me, Edward, don't you see how beautiful your brother looks when he goes to work and he doesn't have to carry it and sit it? What will you learn, Eduardo? I'm learning what? And it took 2 years for her to convince me that I was on the wrong track, and I went back on the piano. I was being a drummer, so I wasn't prepared as much as the pianist. I always said that my brother was a pianist and I'm the piano player, you know? I said, I gotta come up with something different. And since I played drums, since I was left-handed, I could accompany myself in a typical guajeo and solo with the right. Both hands, took me years to do that. Late 61, I started my own orchestra, because I knew from the experience of the other bands that if you're gonna be respected, you have to have your own signature, your own musical language, and I certainly knew how to excite. I knew it intuitively, because I studied the Cuban structures. When I went with Bob Bianco, I learned scientifically why it works. Tension and resistance, that must be in the composition to lead to an exciting musical climax. And that you build up from the piano solo to the bongo, to the timbal, you know, you're creating more and more tension. And when that full tutti comes in on the trombones with the flute, that's gonna blow you out. My Latin jazz is based on instrumental mambos, and you're gonna dance in your chair. I'm like sort of the last of the Mohegans, you know? But if there's any wisdom that I have, is that I don't guess I'm gonna excite you with my band, I know it. And that's what kept this band going throughout the years.
Heat there and we freeze in the winter. It is definitely a basement that nobody in their right mind would have ever rented except Max Gordon. Anyway, once you get down those stairs, you're in heaven. You're away from the world. It's lovely. When we were kids, sometimes we'd come here, believe it or not, to the Village Vanguard. It was the golden age of nightclubs for me. You can go into one club here, Art Tatum, go to the next one here, Billie Holiday, go over across the street, you hear Lester Young. It was heaven. Sitting across from the banquette I was in, and that banquette was Alfred Lyon. I used to collect all those Blue Note records of fabulous early Blue Notes. And I don't know, Alfred and I looked at each other, hi, you know. No. Somehow there was a connection, because a couple of years later we were married. Alfred and I were now venturing into new forms of jazz or new people. Thelonious Monk, to this day, I will never forget it as a cornerstone in my life. Inadvertently, I booked Monk into the Vanguard because I met Max at the Fire Island summer place. I said, you know, there's a great artist, you ought to hear him. I just went up to him cold. Well, that was easy to do in the summer because I had a cute little yellow bathing suit on, and I'm 28. He's Mr. Gordon to me then. Somehow we connected, and I got tired of living in this little one room down in the village, and Max offered me a bigger room a little further on the other side of the village. I decided to take it. Max was not a jazz nut like me. He loved poetry, and he loved writing, and he loved artists. And then Max got involved more with jazz musicians. The sound at the Vanguard is so incredible. There is no recording studio that can equal it, and that's why the musicians like to play there. They can relate to the audience because of the shape of the room, the pie shape. I don't know. It's just beautiful sound. Hey, Miles Davis was there. Bill Evans played for weeks on end. And then Coltrane recorded his masterworks there. And it became a jazz club, total jazz club. And that's how it started. And then when Max died, I didn't have to take the Vanguard over. He never asked me, never thought about it, frankly. That it seemed my whole life was motivated. At the end of the road was the club. The goal was there, and you finally reached it without trying to, but it was preordained, I think. A couple of years ago, all you would hear from people is, jazz is dead, jazz is dead. I said, really? I said, when's the funeral? Because there's so many people coming here to hear jazz. So it's hardly dead, hardly.
Good evening. Welcome to Dizzy's Club Coca-Cola. We're inside Frederick P. Rose Hall. It's the home of jazz at Lincoln Center, and tonight, home of the 2013 National Endowment for the Arts Jazz Masters Award Ceremony. Please welcome our very special person here tonight with so many other special people, Jazz at Lincoln Center's Managing and Artistic Director, and NEA Jazz Master, Mr. Wynton Marsalis.
All right, now, thank you very, very much. Good evening, everybody. Thank you very much. Welcome to the House of Swing. All of us at Jazz at Lincoln Center are again honored to host this year's National Endowment for the Arts Jazz Masters Award Ceremony. We welcome all of you that are here with us tonight, both physically and digitally. Now, whether you're logged onto our live webcast on arts.gov or jalc.org, if you're listening on Sirius XM's Real Jazz Channel, WBGO Radio, or NPR Music, or you might just happen to be one of the guests here in the club, everybody's looking so good and clean out here tonight, this will certainly be a wonderful and warm evening of celebration. We all know each other and have known each other for many, many years, and it's such a wonderful feeling in the room. I wish all of our people out there could see and hear and be here with us. Over the last 31 years, the NEA has named 132 extraordinary men and women as jazz masters, bestowing on them a financial award and amplifying their achievements to the nation and to the world. Additionally, the NEA has supported jazz education, touring, and performances in a myriad of programs for thousands of Americans, consistently reinforcing the values of jazz in our collective cultural consciousness. These values, of course, are universal, but they are specific to jazz, such as individualism, which is about your sound, shared responsibility, swinging together, preparation, you got to practice, improvisation, how to make something out of nothing. The connections and comparisons are profound and many. That the NEA has embraced our music and celebrated its heroes for more than three decades in such a proud and public way is certainly something that we should all applaud. Jazz music. for all of us here in this room and countless people all over the world, it is an art form that we are honored to love. Fortunately, many of our heroes still walk amongst us, and even better, they still play. And so tonight, we're gonna gather to celebrate these giants of jazz, the artists and advocates that have made such a profound impact on this music and on our lives. Now, as we all know, jazz music is at home in any setting. It travels very well. But acts of swing all over the world take place most frequently in clubs. Tonight, we are in a club. So we hope that our honorees and previously named jazz masters will feel right at home. Not only will this year's honorees take the stage, but many other NEA jazz masters will join in the festivities. We're extremely fortunate tonight to have a house band to end all house bands. An NEA Jazz Masters trio boasting some of our music's heaviest heavyweights. To get the music started tonight, please welcome on the drums, 2009 NEA Jazz Master, Jimmy Cobb. And on the bass, 1998 NEA Jazz Master, Ron Carter. And on the piano, 2010 NEA Jazz Master, Kenny Barron.
This is my script. So, on behalf of Ron, Jimmy, and myself, thank you very much, and we're honored, and that's the truth, we're honored to be NEA Jazz Masters and to play together tonight on such an occasion. Throughout the ceremony, some of our esteemed fellow jazz masters will join us on stage or will perform by themselves. We're gonna start with a song written by one who just recently passed away, Mr. Dave Brubeck, a composition of his entitled In Your Own Sweet Way. Thank you.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. Now, please welcome to the stage the acting chairman of the National Endowment for the Arts, Joan Shigekawa.
Thank you, Wynton. It is wonderful to be back here at Jazz at Lincoln Center, celebrating the NEA Jazz Masters Fellowships, which are the highest honor our nation bestows upon jazz musicians and advocates. Since 1982, the Jazz Masters program has elevated to its ranks 128 living legends that have made exceptional contributions to the advancement of jazz. The four individuals being honored tonight will each receive a stipend of $25,000. They will sit for a formal portrait, and they will be interviewed for a Smithsonian oral history. So tonight, we celebrate those four individuals, and we will also salute the full spectrum of artists and advocates that have shaped this uniquely American art form. We are gathered at one of America's truly great cultural institutions, and I would like to thank our partners in presenting tonight's ceremony and celebration. So, our deepest appreciation to the staff, to the crew, and especially Board Chair Bob Appel, sitting over there. Of course, Wynton Marsalis, Greg Scholl, Kat Henry, Jason Olane, and all of their fantastic colleagues. So, thank you. Jazz at Lincoln Center also partners with us in creating and distributing free online curricular materials to help junior high school and high school teachers to share this music and its history with their students. To date, more than 20,000 toolkits are being used in classrooms all across the country. Also like to thank Del Bryant and his colleagues at BMI, who once again joined us to celebrate the Jazz Masters with a wonderful luncheon that they hosted earlier today. Thanks, BMI. So my job is a thank you job, as you may have gathered. I would also like to thank David Freyer. David, where are you? Over there, all right. And all of our partners at Arts Midwest, who manage the Jazz Masters Live program to support touring and residency activities for NEA Jazz Masters throughout the nation. Thank you, David. And next, I would like to acknowledge two members of the NEA's National Council on the Arts who have joined us this evening. So please welcome Paul Hodes, right here, and Barbara Ernst Prey on the other side of the room. And finally, I would like to say a special thank you to all of the organizations and individuals who are hosting special viewing parties for tonight's webcast, which is being live streamed via arts.gov to concert halls, to community centers, and private homes from Los Angeles to Washington, D.C. And now, so this is a breakout moment for us. And now it is my great honor to introduce you to the 2013 class of NEA Jazz Masters seated here in the audience. Would you please welcome Mose Allison? Mose, where are you? This is so cool. Please welcome Lou Donaldson. Where's Lou? Oh, Lou. And please welcome Eddie Palmieri. Where's Eddie? Where is Eddie? And please welcome Deborah Gordon, who is tonight representing her mother, the fabulous Lorraine Gordon. And now I would like to turn things over to the man who is behind everything jazz at the NEA, our director of music and opera, Wayne Brown.
Thank you, Joan. Good evening. With us in person tonight are 24 previously named NEA Jazz Masters representing the distinguished body of jazz legends who continue to advance America's music in our country and around the world. This stellar group of artists define the highest standards of jazz. Please join me in a salute to our previously named NEA Jazz Masters, beginning with 1995 NEA Jazz Master Roy Haynes. Next to 2000 NEA Jazz Master David Baker. ...2001 NEA Jazz Master Randy Weston. ...2002 NEA Jazz Master McCoy Tyner. ...2003 NEA Jazz Master Jimmy Heath. Yay! ...2004 NEA Jazz Master Chico Hamilton. ...2005 NEA Jazz Master Paquito de Rivera. ...2005 NEA Jazz Master George Ween. ...2007 NEA Jazz Master Dan Morgenstern. ...2008 NEA Jazz Master Candido Camaro. 2008 NEA Jazz Master Joe Wilder. 2009 NEA Jazz Master Lee Konitz. 2010 NEA Jazz Master Muhal Richard Abrams. 2010 NEA Jazz Master Annie Ross. 2011 NEA Jazz Master David Liebman. 2011 NEA Jazz Master Branford Marsalis. 2011 NEA Jazz Master Del Feo Marsalis. 2011 NEA Jazz Master Ellis Marsalis. 2011 NEA Jazz Master Jason Marsalis. 2012 NEA Jazz Master Jimmy Owens. 2012 NEA Jazz Master Sheila Jordan. Some of our esteemed NEA Jazz Masters are no longer with us. However, we are delighted to have their family members present to honor their legacy. Please hold your applause until the end. Let us welcome Hilma Carter, wife of 1986 NEA Jazz Master Benny Carter. Maxine Gordon, wife of 1986 NEA Jazz Master Dexter Gordon. Diana Flanagan, wife of 1996 NEA Jazz Master Tommy Flanagan. Sandra Jackson, wife of 1997 NEA Jazz Master Milt Jackson. And Joanne Robinson Hill, wife of 2008 NEA Jazz Master Andrew Hill. And now on with the show. Please welcome NEA Jazz Master George Ween, who will introduce our first 2013 NEA Jazz Master of the Evening.
You made it. As they introduced all the different jazz masters, I could see my whole life passing in front of me. And it really is quite a thrill to be here. As UB Blake used to say, it's a thrill to be anywhere when you get to be the age of some of us here, you know. But I really first met Mose at Newport in 64. Maybe I met Mose, did I meet you before 64 in Newport? I don't know, where is he? Over here, okay. I can't remember, but I don't think so, because neither of us are much older than starting in 1964, you know, so we have to accept that. But the point is, jazz in itself is unique music. And the musicians that play jazz are unique individuals, unique artists. But Mose Allison is unique in many different ways, because not only is he a fine pianist, with his own identity as pianist, which is all what all jazz musicians look for, is their identity. He has a vocal quality that gives him his own identity, and he writes music. But the music he writes is not only played by jazz musicians, it's played by folk artists, it's played by rock artists, and his music has become part of the American music scene. And so, Duke Ellington would say that Mose Allison is beyond category. And at this point, I'm so proud to see that Mose Allison receives the award for the NEA Jazz Master 2013. Mose. Yeah.
To say the least. And I didn't expect to get this award. And I'm happy. I'd like to bring my a daughter up to sing one of my songs.
Most of the honored jazz masters among us tonight ply our trade on the bandstand, but many work tirelessly beyond the stage. One such advocate is A.B. Spellman, a true Renaissance man who has worked tirelessly to elevate the awareness, understanding, and appreciation of our music. Please join me in welcoming the jazz master for whom the A.B. Spellman Jazz Advocacy Award is named.
Hello, everybody. We've lost three very valued jazz masters this year. John Levy, Von Freeman, and most recently, Dave Brubeck. John Levy was an unusual person because, first of all, the man, last time I saw him, he was 95 years old, and he was going to work every day and still managing artists in the most compassionate and efficient way. He would have been up here as a jazz master, as a bassist, if he hadn't given up his craft and gone back behind the scenes to work hard to make sure that the music got put before the public. Now, I know personally what a great sacrifice this is. It really hurts to give up your art to help other artists. But people have to do that in order for their art to get out there among the public, and John Levy did that. He was such a trusted and competent person that many of his artists never had contracts. That's hard thing to happen among agents these days. I've heard a lot of musicians say a lot of bad things about agents, but I've never heard anybody say a bad word about John Levy. And I know that Nancy Wilson never had a contract with him. That's how much she trusted him. And so, yeah, John Levy's gone. Von Freeman, Jimmy Heath, who's here somewhere, Jimmy likes to talk about traveling as a saxophonist and going to different towns and how if you don't watch out for certain cats in those towns, you'll get your butt kicked. And he was talking about Buck Hill, who's a saxophonist in Washington, D.C., who a lot of people never heard of. He never left D.C. Still kept his job at the post office, but he kicked a lot of butt, everybody's butt who came through there. He blew them down. Von Freeman was such a person in Chicago. Von Freeman was along with who Clifford Jordan and a couple of others. Johnny Griffin. Thanks. I hate it when that happens. You know, you reach a certain age and then your brain starts leaking. You know, and I wonder where I couldn't think of, that's why I say the little giant. And anyway, was one of the founders of the Chicago style of saxophone playing. I don't know if I can really define that style, but it was, I knew it had blues at the base of it. It was a chest tone, not a head tone. And it had a lot of hard, hard swing in it. And Von Freeman could seriously blow. And he held up Chicago for many, many decades. And then there was Dave Brubeck. Dave Brubeck, well, first of all, as you all know, he made a whole lot of great music of a lot of different kinds. He had the most stable quartet anybody ever had, with another voice in it, which was just magnificent, with Paul Desmond. And he wrote a lot of great music, as you heard with in Your Own Sweet Way, which Kenny Barron, who's got to have the greatest touch in the world, made such an eloquent statement of. His song like that is like the Mendelssohn songs without words, and you hear the music, and it's all music, but it's as if there were words in it because it talks to you in the way that a good poem does. And but he was also a groundbreaking educator and a person who, along with, I think, the MJQ, opened up a lot of places that had been closed to jazz for a long time, a lot of concert halls, a lot of college campuses. And so his legacy is lasting. Lives like this are so rich, so full, so productive, so creative, that they can't really be mourned. They can only be celebrated. And these are people we build statues to in our hearts. Thank you. Now, Nat Hentoff once wrote that he had hung out with congressmen, senators, movie stars, all kinds of people who have a lot of national acclaim. But there's nobody he'd rather hang out with than jazz musicians because they are the best people in the world, he said. One such person is coming to the stand now, and that's Randy Weston. Randy is one of the warmest people you can ever meet. Humble, brilliant as a musician, jealous of his heritage, and just a person whose company and whose music you want to be in the room with. Randy Weston.
Thank you so much. We're going to do a special tribute to the great Dave Brubeck, the great Von Freeman. And who was the other one?
John Levy.
Say it again.
John Levy.
One more time.
John Levy.
I remember when John Levy was managing the George Shearing Quintet. I've known John a long, long time. We played for him about 20 years ago. Anyhow, High Fly is a story of a rhythm that I heard. And with that rhythm, I just put some chords to it, you know? So tonight, let's have a spontaneous musical tribute to these great artists. And I want to also add Mr. Ted Kirson and Miss Jane Cortez, who passed a few weeks ago. And When I look in this audience and I see these incredible musicians, but one reason why I went to the continent, the place of origin, because I wanted to find out where this music comes from. Where did Louis come from? How did this whole concept of approaching music in that way? And I had the great pleasure of hearing music. It was so spiritual, it's so connected to the universe, you know? And that's the foundation that we have with this music. So let's take the fly. I don't know where the fly's gonna go, but with Ron and Jimmy, I can't go wrong. A few variations on High Fly.
Thank you.
How many different ways have you heard Randy Weston play that? Yeah. Well, Lorraine Gordon. Lorraine and Alfred Lyon were working very hard, and their partner Frank Wolf were recording a lot of jazz classicists like Meade Lux Lewis and Albert Ammons and Sidney Bechet, people like that, and not paying a lot of attention to modern jazz. When Ike Quebec took them up to that walking catharsis's apartment, Thelonious Monk, and sat there as Monk played for hours, you know, his almost entire repertoire. And of course, their minds were completely blown. And of course, they completely changed direction in their lives. And of course, they recorded Thelonious Monk and those wonderful Blue Note recordings. Now, if Lorraine had done nothing else but go around and shill for Monk, she would have qualified in my mind. She worked tirelessly going around to every DJ she could find, every club owner she could find, trying to interest people in Thelonious Monk's music, every press outlet. But Monk was thought by anybody who wasn't in this really hip bebop circle as being just weird. And nobody really understood his music, and so nobody really bought on it. And so they kept working at it. And then she finally got him a gig, or at least he kind of finally got to meet Max Gordon over at the Village Vanguard. And that was a deal, too, because the Vanguard hadn't been playing a lot of jazz. They had been having poetry readings. They had been having, like, a lot of folk music concerts. And then, of course, Monk came in, and their direction changed. She, of course, married Max Gordon again and stayed there, and that's probably what we know her most by today. Now, the best place to listen to small group jazz is the environment that it grew up in, which is the club. Now, we're very glad that concert halls are finally booking this music, and we welcome those concerts because, A, I don't go out that late anymore, and I like going to music that starts at 8 o'clock. But still, the environment of the club, where you have this kind of intimacy, and the audience sits inside the music, and the musicians can feel the audience, and the audience can feel the music, it's still the best environment for small group jazz. And so a good jazz club has to have that kind of natural feeling to it. And if it's a little funky and some of the wallpaper's a little faded and you can see sort of fly stains around on the pictures on the wall, that's all right. That's all right. It's got to have you call it the blues element of the room. So the Vanguard has been that kind of room for many, many decades. You can think about how many records in your collection were recorded live at the Vanguard. I'll just mention a couple. Sonny Rollins, live at the Vanguard from 1959. His breakout recordings, records that made you know that this was a true genius of modern music. Betty Carter. One of her very, very best records, live at the Vanguard. And then, of course, there's John Coltrane, live at the Vanguard, with all those fantastic cadenzas on I Want to Talk About You. Those mind-blowing things, about three of them in there, and then you go, ooh, every time you listen to one, it just your brain is transported to another dimension altogether. All out of that room. It's a room that accommodates the music because it belongs to the music, and the music belongs to it. So having kept this tradition of good taste around, or having kept a bastion of the music, jazz does not have enough bastions today. This is one, this place is one, the Village Vanguard is another. Otherwise, the bastions are falling all around the country, including the radio stations, and I won't talk about that. So for having kept this bastion alive, having had the good taste, so that every time you come to New York, this is a destination you want to go to, and you know that there's going to be something really good there, and that you're going to enjoy hearing it because it's going to feel right. I want to give the NEA Jazz Master Award for advocacy to Lorraine Gordon. Her daughter, Deborah Gordon, is going to accept it for her.
Thank you. I'm very nervous. I brought my own notes, not provided by here. Lorraine wouldn't have to bring notes. For those of you who know her, she would, I'm sure, have lots of words, maybe some not allowed by the FCC, I don't know. But she asked us, me and Jed, to come here tonight to accept this award on her behalf because she hasn't been feeling well. And when she first heard about receiving this award, the NEA Jazz Masters, we talked about what it meant to her. And a few things do stick in my mind from that conversation. Of course, she was very concerned about what she would wear. But the first thing she did say to me was that this honor really belongs to Max. And she got no argument there from me. And she also expressed how lucky she feels to be part of this community of great musicians and music lovers. So I thank you on behalf of Lorraine and Max and everybody at the Village Vanguard. Thank you for this honor.
Thank you very much.
I mentioned how some of my favorite people in the world were jazz musicians, and I have the privilege of calling up to the stand one of my very favorite jazz musicians, my favorite people, Little Bird himself, a great musician, composer, raconteur, the wonderful Jimmy Heath. Kenny Barron is going to come back. Two Philly guys are going to come back and collaborate on this next thing.
I just want to say this one is for you, Lorraine, from the Heath brothers. And you'll recognize the melody.
Jimmy Heath. Jimmy Heath. Thank you very much. Kenny Barron, Ron Carter, Jimmy Cobb. Thank you very, very much. Now it's a great pleasure to bring up jazz vocalist, wonderful vocalist, and 2012 Jazz Master, Miss Sheila Jordan.
Man, this is a heavy audience. I have to tell you. I want to congratulate all the recipients of the 2013 Jazz Masters Award. It's a joy to be here, and I'm thrilled to see everybody. So I'm going to do my blues called Sheila's Blues. Well, I was born in Detroit, Michigan, back in 19. Oh, yeah, yeah. Born in Detroit, Michigan. November the 18th, Mickey Mouse's birthday. But my mother, she was only 17 years old and she couldn't raise me. So she sent me to live with my grandparents in a small coal mining town in Pennsylvania State. Grew up with the coal miners singing in the beer garden every Saturday night. The miners used to sit around and drink their beer and whiskey and sing their songs. You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. Rarely, 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 they ever fight, moved back to Detroit when I was about 14, hanging down at the club Sudan. Well, that was everybody's scene. You didn't have to be 21 years old to get in there. It was just a place for kids to play and sing. Well, we were always chasing Charlie Parker. I think he wrote that song for us. Chasing the bird, chasing the bird, chasing the bird. When he used to work at the club Elsino, where you had to be 21 years old to get in, I forged my mother's birth certificate. Wore a hat with a veil, high-heeled shoes that were killing my feet, smoking my Lucky Strike cigarettes. I was gonna get in the door to hear the bird. But the man said, hey, little white girl, you better go home and do your homework. So I went round in the alley, on the garbage cans. Bird knew I was there, and he opened up the door and he played his heart out for me. Oh, what a treat, what a treat, what a treat, what a treat for a 14-year-old kid that loved jazz. Oh, yeah. Thank you.
A skinny little teenager by the nickname of Jeannie Dawson, running down on John R. to buy all those Bebop 78 records. Yeah, that was the time. I wouldn't be up here singing with these fantastic musicians at 84 years old for you tonight. Oh, oh, oh.
Miss Sheila Jordan. Sheila Jordan. Okay. And now here to say a few words about Eddie Palmieri. Please welcome 2002 NEA Jazz Master McCoy Tyner. Hope you all enjoyed the food. All right. Yes, sir.
Sure wore my tux.
Yes, sir. That's all right. You are a tux. You are a tux.
Thank you very much for staying over. And what I'm about to present an award to a gentleman I respect so much in the Latin world. Eddie Palmieri.
Ladies and gentlemen, and all the masters that are here tonight, my highest honor is that gentleman that just introduced me, Mr. McCoy Tyner. Around 1965, going into 66, excuse me, my trombonist, Mr. Barry Rogers, which my best, every leader I believe should have a best bandstand buddy, and I certainly had him in Mr. Barry Rogers. We played the Palladium, which we did 16 sets in 4 days for $72. The Palladium had the 802 Gorillet for an $18 scale every night at the Palladium. And I also did what we call the graveyard shift, which was in the summer in 1956, which I started at the Palladium, with Vicentico Valdez, who was the singer of Tito Puente earlier, and he made his own conjunto, great conjunto. And this is where I learned the Cuban structures that I utilize constantly till this day. Okay. Mr. Barry Rogers comes to me, he says, Eddie, oh, by the way, by that time they had lost their liquor license. Okay. They had a lot of problems. There was a lot of reports downtown. They were very abusive, the bouncers with the patrons that came to, you know, to you, they threw them down two flights of stairs, they say. And the bouncers were in a good mood that night, you know. So, because there used to be a dance studio right across the street from the Ed Sullivan Theater. Okay. So, the first band that would play, that would be me, let's say it was Tito Puente, he always had top billing. So I would play the first set, then I played the second set about 20 minutes later, all 45-minute sets approximately. Then Tito Puente would come and play his first set. I come for the third set, and now we're really starting to go after Tito, you know. And by Tito plays the second set, my fourth set, I'm going for the juggler. Okay. So the thing, main thing is that Barry Rogers, we got out of early, he said, I want you to hear something very, very special. I said, of course, let's go. He took me to the Birdland on a Sunday night. And when I arrived there, the original John Coltrane quartet was playing. And Mr. Coltrane was taking a solo. I sat down, Elvin Jones, Jimmy Garrison, and the one and only to meet Mr. McCoy Tyner. And everything was going great. I was, oh my goodness. You know, because I really never comprehended jazz. You know, I was always into the Latin Cuban rumba with my maracas and that, you know. So all of a sudden I see Mr. Coltrane put down his saxophone and he sits down on a table. It wasn't packed on a Sunday night and he starts, I guess he was writing the payroll, I guess, you know. I don't know what he was writing. All I know is that he gives the solo to Mr. McCoy Tyner. And 5 minutes go by, 10 minutes go by, 50 minutes go by. I would say between 15 and 20 to 25 minutes go by, and Mr. McCoy Tyner is still soloing. And by this time, the tension and resistance within his solo is bringing it to such a high climax, you know, that I couldn't believe it. And now his left hand is completely blurred. And that moment, I said, I've never seen or heard anyone play like that, Mr. McCoy Tyner. I love you very much. You are truly, truly the greatest pianist I've seen on stage. Thank you so very much. Thank you. You don't have to get up. You don't have to get up. You are truly my mentor. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And I want to use this night to also acknowledge my brother, Charlie Palmieri. And Candido, which is only four Hispanics in this incredible honor that has been bestowed on me, Candido Morales, and Paquito de Rivera, and Mr. Ray Barreto, who his son Chris is here. And he was also, I want you to know that your dad was a great bandstand warrior, like Machito, Tito Puente, Tito Rodriguez, my brother, and your father. And I didn't stay too far behind. You know? So thank you very, very much. And I dedicate this to my wife, my two beautiful daughters that are here, and my son, Eddie Palmieri II, who's been managing me for 20 years, and I believe this year he'll start getting paid. And to Mr. Jim Castle, who does the booking, and from now on, don't send my son the check, send it to me. Thank you. Thank you very, very much.
Mr. Eddie Palmieri. Yes, sir. Mr. Eddie Palmieri, come on now. Yes, indeed. Our next NEA Jazz Master inductee has been heard on recordings for more than 60 years, and he was playing a lot longer than that. Here to introduce him, please welcome back to the stage, Mr. Jimmy Cobb.
Good evening. I'm here to introduce a friend of mine who I met a long time ago when I came from Washington, D.C. to New York. He was one of the first people I saw, you know, and I was wondering about him because he was always around people like Bird and all that place. He had a place on 110th Street called Paradise or something where Big Nick Nicholas used to have a band, like have a trio and then have people come in and jam. So I never met this fella until way later, but I used to see a lot of pictures of him around the wall with these very famous guys, Charlie Parker, you know, Miles, and you know, everybody. Because he was back in the age where he came from one of those liners, Carolina, North Carolina, South Carolina. And he was down there, and everybody heard him, told him he should come to New York and home and skills, you know. So he got up here, and he was at all the little jam sessions. As he said on the tape, he could always find a jam session, because in Harlem was about 10 places that you could play, you know, like so. And you could play like from 9 o'clock to 5 o'clock in the morning. You know, the legal places probably closed, like you said, at 12 o'clock. Then the after hour joints started out. So it was a whole lot of music going on. So I didn't have a chance to meet him then because I came to town to join Earl Bostic's band and down in Washington. So I met him at 125th Street and St. Nicholas Avenue, and we went right out of town. So we went cross country, like maybe I probably rode to California on the jump seat of a Cadillac for about 3 times. That's a hard one, that album. And I still was seeing pictures of him and Bird and everybody together. So way later we had occasion to be together. You know, we had a couple of gigs. I played with him in Pittsburgh, I think, in his band for one night, but that was short. And then we had an occasion to go to Japan together, you know. And his Japan, his name is Rue Donaldson. So we had occasion to do that, and I got to know him pretty good. And then occasionally we would play a little golf, you know, because I think, and when he was growing up, he was a caddy for Sam Snead, if anybody knows who that is. Yeah, so he learned to play golf a little bit. So we used to go and play because he lives about 2 blocks from two golf courses uptown, you know, uptown New York, Split Rock and Pelham. So we used to go up there and play a little bit. And I used to tell him, I say, well, I said, don't get your ball down in the woods. He said, I don't get my ball, but I read a book and said, you're supposed to hit it straight. So we got that kind of a relationship going. And then he's a guy that he has a lot of opinions about a lot of things, you know. So he'll tell you in a minute, he'll say, oh, that guy can't play no saxophone. He'll say that in a minute, you know, but maybe most times he might be true. But he's a good guy, and he's always been right with me because he tells me, he says, you know, all them records that Miles Davis made, the good ones, and you on. So that made him and me all right. So we all right now, you know, and I would like to introduce you to this friend of mine for a few years now. His name is, in English, is Lou Donaldson.
Thank you very much, Jimmy, for that wonderful introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm finally made it into this NEA Jazz Masters program. I didn't press it, but I was wondering. Why it took so long. I thought I would be in here in the 50s, you know. But with the advent of the modern medicine, I'm able to make it at the age of 86. I know we have a lot of octogenarians out there. I can see them struggling to get up on the stage. So I'm going to give you some good advice. Three new medicines that weren't around back in the days will give you longevity. Number one is Viagra. Very important. Number two is Cialis. Very important. Number three is Levitra. Very important. Now, the first time I tried Viagra, nothing happened. First time I tried Cialis, nothing happened. Then I tried Levitra, nothing happened. And I got frustrated and took all three of them at one time. 2 weeks later, after I got out of the hospital, I was all right. Now, when I walk down the street in my neighborhood, the women see me, they walk on the other side of the street. Talking one day, and one of them said, "That goes that, you know, use the N-word on me." Said, "Look at that, he got two Viagras in his coat pocket and one down in his shoe." He said he calls that the Mariano Rivera pill. Because if the two up top don't work, he goes to the bullpen and brings in a little relief pitcher. So that's why I'm still here today. So try that formula, I think you'll be happy. Now, the Jazz Masters is a great program. I've been following it for many years, and it's a very special award and a very special position for musicians that have struggled and have come through this tough business and made some kind of mark. And it's very hard to do that because, you know, in the music business and entertainment business, and any other entertainment business, you have to have some kind of a gimmick. But the Jazz Masters is just a award to a musician who has earned his keep. He paid his dues. And now the NEA is awarding him with his reward. And that's what we'd like to say thank you. And also a special thank to Wynton Marsalis, who has his teaching classes and teaches the kids how to play jazz and understand jazz. And he runs the gamut because he starts at ragtime, comes to Dixieland. He plays swing, and he plays bebop, and then he plays some of this music that they play today. I don't know what that is, but young musicians, you know. They still living at home with mom and papa playing the dues, so they don't have to worry about work. But as soon as they have to play for a living, they'll change that tune. I guarantee you. Now tonight, we'd like to bring back up the Unholy Trio, Ron Carter and Kenny Barron, yeah. Jimmy Cobb. I'm gonna play a little tune that I recorded in 1958. It was a big hit in Afghanistan. So we're gonna try it out tonight and see how it works at Dizzy's Club. I'm sure you know it if you know anything about me, but if you don't, the hell with it, we're gonna play it anyway.
Donaldson. Lou Donaldson. Yes, indeed. Sweet Papa Lou. Well, this has been a night of celebration and swing and comedy. We fed it our newest NEA Jazz Master inductees, and we've heard some inspired and inspiring music from the bandstand. As we prepare to say farewell, we would like to invite up fellow NEA Jazz Master saxophonist, well, he's playing clarinet, Paquito de Rivera. And Dave Liebman, I think that's a soprano. They're gonna take us right on forward to the blues.
They oriented me to say something. But as I regularly say, I will be very brief because I have mainly only 100 words in English. And 50 of them are dirty. I learned them from my English teacher, Patato Valdez. I perfected my language with Eddie Palmieri, you know. When he disappeared, you know, a few minutes ago, I thought that finally he got deported. And now he's still here. I have to tell you something. Well, I am so proud to be. I never dreamed, you know, in my wildest dream that I'm going to be surrounded with so many fantastic musicians and people that I admire all my life. But I have a very special story to tell you. And it's about a favorite of Eddie and a favorite of mine, of a favorite of many people, about the great McCoy Tyner. McCoy was one of the first great master of this music that gave me a gig in this country. And in those days, I still was living in my mother's house, my mother's apartment in Union City. It's only Cubans there. You nobody speaks English there at all. You know, it's black bean land. So I didn't have a car in those days, and didn't have not even a license to drive. And McCoy was kind enough to say, no, I'm going to pick you up and I tell you, I think it was in Delaware, right? Delaware was that club or something. No? Delaware Gap. Well, Delaware Water Gap. That was a wonderful club that I have some airplanes hanging from the ceilings and all that. Well, the thing is that my mother, I said, I'm going to take a shower, prepare myself because Mr. McCoy Tyner is going to pick me up. You know, it's a wonderful pianist. I explained to her too, the piano for John Coltrane. And then finally, Mr. Tyner arrived at home and knocked the door. And my mother opened the door and then he comes and said, amen. There is a very elegant foreigner looking for you outside. a foreigner. Yeah, he's speaking English. So, oh, he speaks English. Very interesting. What is his name? He says he played the piano. Very kind, very gentle person. And his name is Tim McCoy. I said, Tim McCoy is an old cowboy. Well, that sounds to me like a cowboy, but he says he's a pianist. And he's black, too. So Tim McCoy was a white cowboy. I think you're mistaken, somebody. When they went out, it was Mr. McCoy Tyner. Thank you for backing. Thank you.
Dave Liebman, Paquito de Rivera, Jimmy Cobb, Ron Carter, Kenny Barron. Please join me in thanking our presenters tonight, as well as all of the staff from the NEA and Jazz at Lincoln Center. But most of all, let me thank all of you for joining us tonight and coming together to honor and celebrate jazz music. Thank you. Thank you, NEA, and thank you, NEA Jazz Masters. I hope all of y'all enjoyed the food and had a great time. Be safe getting home. Have a good night. Thank you very much. Bye.